You're listening to the MindPod Network.
Friends, listeners, and fellow travelers, head on over to zachleary.com/journeys. Check out Toward the Within, Guided Mystical Journeys for the Digital Age, a new offering that I have going on, promoting an authentic life and helping you to get unstuck. Go check it out.
It's all happening. 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 It's all happening.
Hello, friends. Welcome to the podcast, episode 131 of It's All Happening with Zach Leary. That is me. I'm your host. So happy to be back with you guys on the podcast airwaves. This week on the podcast, we have author of the new book, Zucked, Waking Up to the Facebook Catastrophe, the legendary Roger McNamee. Roger is truly a legend in the Valley of Silicon. He has had his toes, his fingers, and his advice in many of the great innovations over the last 30 to 40 years through the context of being a really thoughtful, innovative, and creative venture capitalist. But this new book, Zucked, I'll just say straight out of the gate right away, early on in the podcast, this is one of the most important podcasts that I have ever done. And I am so grateful to be a part of it. So grateful for Roger to stop by and do it in person. So, being a part of what exactly? What is this problem? What is the social media, the internet, technology run amok problem that we are currently facing? The book Zucked, How to Wake Up from the Facebook Catastrophe. You know, Roger has become an expert on this. He is become truly a Silicon Valley activist on the matter. And I think if you follow social media and follow the news, you certainly have been made aware of stories like Cambridge Analytica and, you know, all the privacy breaches on Facebook and things of that nature. But I wanted to give a couple minutes of how I see the problem, of how I see the juxtaposition of information wanting to be free and also a responsible, I guess, happy medium of layers of common sense that somehow need to be incorporated into these technologies. You know, as it stands now, if we simply let these internet platforms that we know and love, that we use every day, without even really thinking about it much at this point, if we let them go unchecked, we will continue to see the nefarious results of the collective behaviors of all of us continue to negatively influence our society. It's not that the people running these companies are bad people with evil intentions. I don't think Mark Zuckerberg or Larry and Sergey are bad people. It's just that they are running technologies and platforms that have simply gotten too big and have become too influential. They're just simply just so gargantuan when you're running a platform that has 2 billion active users. The content and the people who are posting that content must have some kind of filter that prevents them from going completely anarchic and manipulating the platform to confuse the user. if you just sit idly by and go, well, it's just a platform, how users use it, isn't really entirely, it's not up to us. Of course, there are hate speech things and things of that nature, and crimes can't be committed, but the rest, whatever happens, happens, right? Back in the early days, I should say the formative years of cyberspace, great minds like John Perry Barlow, who co-founded the EFF, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, were basically coming from a place of libertarian activism, coming from the place that information wants to be free. And in Barlow's legendary A Declaration of the Independence of Cyberspace, he writes, "We have no elected government, nor are we likely to have one. So I address you with no greater authority than with which liberty itself always speaks. I declare the social space we are building to be naturally independent of the tyrannies you seek to impose on us. You have no moral right to rule us, nor do you possess any methods of enforcement. We have true reason to fear." So, Google, or God, Rogers would kill me to say Google, but search somehow a Declaration of the Independence of Cyberspace written by Barlow. Let's see, when was that written? That was written in 1996. Yes, that long ago. Barlow was way, way ahead of the game. You know, that fundamental, libertarian, egalitarian way of looking at the miracle of the internet is a fantastic thing. It is still a beautiful thing to take part of today and to believe in. However, when we are facing problems that we are facing today, it's a tricky thing because we cannot just sit back and let Russian bots and Russian troll factories completely manipulate the content of certain political ideologies taking down other political ideologies in the process. We can't just sit back and watch that happen, and censorship is not a good thing, of course, but these, gargantuan, tools that we are using on a daily basis, they are beyond just the benign, neutral, opinionless, delivery mechanism for content. They are how people get the news. They are how people get develop political opinions. They are how people, share their ideologies and so on and so forth. So if people are learning about certain issues, especially political legislation or social issues like Black Lives Matter, if this is where people go to learn about this stuff, something, I would say common sense dictates that something must be put in place to make sure that the content that is being put forward to educate a population must be coming from a good place. So that is what I believe. The book Zucked, How to Wake Up from the Facebook Catastrophe by Roger McNamee. Roger began his career in 1982 and has managed so many amazing top performing funds in Silicon Valley. And his current group is called Elevation Partners, and that started in 2004. And it is a partnership focused at the intersection of media and technology. But since 2017, Roger has engaged, along with former Google design ethicist Tristan Harris, in a campaign to trigger a national conversation about the dark side of social media. So here you go. Here's the podcast. I really hope you enjoy it. And of course, pick up a copy of the book. Dig it.
Roger.
Andrew McNamee. Thank you for coming.
Oh, Zach, it is so much fun to be here, man. It's really cool. It's fun to see you someplace other than backstage at a show.
At a Grateful Dead show, right? So the first thing I wanted to ask, I wanted to kind of set the stage by having you explain from your perspective, from what it is you do in your incarnation here on the planet, which is different than what the rest of us do, and your relationship with technology can be different as an investor. What was attractive to Facebook to you in the early days?
So imagine
from that perspective.
Yeah. So imagine that I've spent my life since 1982, immersed in Silicon Valley.
82. Wow, okay.
So I got there when they, at the very tail end of what I would call the Apollo period, when it's still the guys with the short sleeve shirts and a tie and a plastic pocket protector. The guys you see in Apollo 13, right?
Yeah.
And the space shuttle is like the big thing. And, you know, various electronics for the military and the government are what they make there.
Yeah.
And the PC industry is just beginning to happen. So I arrive and I get there and, you know, the PC industry is all people my age, right? People born in 1956 or 57. So
right.
Steve Jobs, the Bill Gates and all those guys were born in the same window. And I get really lucky because I'm a musician and it turns out that the computer geeks are no different than the music geeks in that when they're on the road, they don't go out to bars at night. They have a jam session. The problem was most of them only knew like a verse and a chorus, if that. And I'd been playing Happy Hour forever, so I like knew hundreds of songs. So I was like instantly welcomed into this thing and became part of the social scene of that. And that was a huge advantage because they were really cool people. I mean, I'm very nerdy, and it was really easy for me to hang because we all like the same. I mean, they were all deadheads. They were all, you know, we were all into the same music, and you know, they were just. It was a really.
They're an extension of that movement.
Totally. I mean, you sit there and you think through how, you know, I mean, how tightly tied into the sort of the Merry Pranksters, Grateful Dead. Then you see The Well, right?
Yeah.
They're all of these things that, you know, that came literally not just accidentally, but directly at the intersection of of those worlds. And I got to occupy both, right? I got to be, you know, I wasn't like you. I wasn't backstage in the old days at the Grateful Dead. I was out in the front of the house with everybody else. But I was at hundreds of shows. But I also was a computer nerd, right? And so in 2006, when Facebook is 2 years old, and Mark Zuckerberg is 22.
Jesus.
I get an email from one of his colleagues saying, my boss has got this really huge business issue. And I know you don't know him, but he needs to talk to somebody who's been around a really long time.
His boss being Zuck.
Yeah.
Okay.
He needs to talk to somebody who's been around a long time, but who's objective and, you know, not conflicted. And would you mind taking a meeting? I'm going like, well, you know, I'm pretty free next week. He's going to, how about 1 o'clock? Like, you know, 2 hours from now. So you have to imagine the scene. My office was, you know, in Silicon Valley, but we had this brand new fund where my partners were Bono from U2 and a bunch of other people, including John Riccitiello, who had been the president of Electronic Arts. And we thought we were going to do a lot of stuff in video games. So we had configured one of our conference rooms like a living room with this giant flat screen TV, a massive stereo, and this arcade video game thing that had been configured so you could play literally any arcade game ever made. Like, the industry has the standard software package with an emulation of literally every, so maybe it probably had 5,000 games on it.
Excellent.
Yeah, in like every version. Like, you could play version 3.2, whatever game you wanted to play.
Right.
So this room is completely soundproof because otherwise you could never get anything done, right? Because if anybody was doing anything in there, it was too loud. So it's totally dead room. So, but it's comfy. It's got nice chairs in it. So Mark comes by. He's 22. He looks just like you imagine. He's got the hoodie, the flip-flops, the courier bag. He sits down. I sit down. We're like 3 feet apart. I'm in a comfy chair. He's in a comfy chair. And I say, dude, before you say anything, I got to tell you some background. Because once you start talking, you're just going to assume that everything I say after that is affected by what you told me. So I want to give you some context. And I said, look, I've been following this industry for a long time. And if it hasn't already happened, either Microsoft or Yahoo is going to offer $1 billion to Facebook. Now, here's the thing. Facebook had just finished a year where they had revenue of $9 million, which sounds like a lot of money, right? But in truth, they hadn't even figured it out. I mean, it was, they were basically doing display ads for pizza parlors, right? I mean, it was, the ads weren't working and they weren't selling that.
They were still closed then.
Oh, yes. It was just high school students and college students.
.edu stuff.
And they didn't even have news feed. It was just literally a Facebook.
Right.
But it was already obvious he had something magical because he required two things that nobody had ever done before. Not MySpace, not Friendster. He had, because everybody had to have a school address, you had authenticated identification. You knew who people were. And that was a tremendous way to limit trolling.
Ah, okay.
Anonymity, it turned out, was the great mistake of the internet because we all assumed that, hey, everybody's going to be like us. And it turned out, no, not everybody was like us.
Right.
So you get trolls. The other thing he had was he gave you control of who could see your stuff. Real privacy settings. So I'm convinced this is a great idea. So I go, dude, either Microsoft or Yahoo's going to offer $1 billion. Everybody you know, your mom and dad, your board of directors, everybody in the company's going to tell you, grab the money, dude. It's $1 billion. We had $9 million in revenue last year, right?
Yeah.
But I want you to understand, I think that Facebook is going to be as big and important as Google is now. Which, by the way, wasn't even remotely obvious to most people then. But I was convinced it was true. And I said, I think you've broken the code. I think you've got the thing. And I said, if you believe your vision, you got to tell everybody. When the deal comes in, you got to say to them, no, I'm not going to take it because they're going to kill it.
Yeah.
And more importantly, no entrepreneur in history ever had the perfect idea at the perfect time twice. Think about Steve Jobs, right?
Right.
He had the perfect idea twice, but Pixar took him 10 years to get it off the ground.
Right.
And
Apple is the continuation of one idea split in two.
Right. And Apple, I would actually also argue, didn't happen overnight either. Right. Not the way that Facebook was happening.
That's true. Yeah.
I mean, Facebook and Twitter are the two things where you sit there and you go, wow, they got it right on the first day.
Yeah. Lightning in the bottle. Sure.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so anyway, what happens after that would have completely freaked you out. You've been in lots of sound studios. You know how quiet they are. So I've just laid on this guy, this really heavy thing, right? And I'm thinking to myself, I've just really laid it out there. And I've really exposed myself. So what does he do? Nothing. He's just sitting and thinking about it. And it's like, if you've ever sat in a completely deadened room,
that's interesting.
When you're expecting somebody to respond and they don't respond for 15 seconds, it seems like forever. Well, at 1 minute, I'm thinking, this is really weird. At 2 minutes, I'm thinking, wow, he's really thinking about this, but this is starting to become uncomfortable. At 3 minutes, I'm basically, my fingernails are starting to dig into the furniture. At 4 minutes, I'm ready to scream. Finally, sometime between 4 and 5 minutes, he goes, you're not going to believe this, but what you just said, that's why I'm here. That's just happened.
The Yahoo deal.
He just says one of those. He doesn't say Yahoo right away.
Right.
He just says, that's exactly what happened. And exactly what you predict has happened. How did you know? And I go, dude, I didn't know. I've just been around here a long time. This is the reason you're here. I've been around a long time. And this is what people around here do. And he goes,
wow, amazing.
And I said, well, do you want to sell the company? He goes, well, everybody wants me to sell it. I said, well, that's not what I asked. I said, do you want to sell it? And he goes, well, I really believe my vision. I really don't want to sell it, but I kind of feel like I can't say no if everybody else is saying yes. And I said, hang on, dude. They all signed up for your vision. If you believe in it, you can say to them, guys, you signed up for the vision, and I believe in it. And I said, if you're right about the vision, and I'm convinced you are, they're going to eventually thank you. Right? They're going to be really happy they didn't sell out. Anyway, it takes them probably another 10 minutes. We figure out how to explain it to him. I basically show him how to make it so that he's not jamming it down their throat. He's doing this in a way where everybody can walk out of there going, okay, this was a completely good outcome, right? Mm-hmm. So he leaves after half an hour. So the first meeting is only half an hour. Like, the following week, he invites me over to his office. And, you know, you go in there. He's right near the Stanford University campus in Palo Alto, right, literally 100 yards from the edge of the campus. And there's like graffiti all over the walls. I mean, really serious, high grade, like pro graffiti. And I'm going like, you know, it's like this cement block building with like really huge and intense graffiti all over the place and posters. And it's like, this is unusual. But the thing that attracted me to him was that, you know, all tech entrepreneurs are intense. It just comes with the territory.
Sure.
And they got to be smart. They got to be focused. But the thing that attracted me was that almost 5 minutes of silence was him thinking hard about whether he trusted me and then making a judgment that he did. And that was, for me, that was super powerful, right? That was like, you know, nerds are my tribe. And so I'm used to them being socially awkward.
Yeah, right.
And the fact that he listened so carefully was really flattering.
Interesting,
right?
Yeah.
And so I was drawn to him right off the shoot. And for the 3 years that I advised him, he was uniformly really cool to work with. Okay, I didn't see any of the stuff you see in the social network.
Yeah. Well, I remember at the time, like right around this time that you're describing, I was working for Apple at the time, and I remember Steve being like very publicly supportive. Like, I'm really impressed that this guy Mark Zuckerberg left the money on the table, and he's committed to building this vision, to building a company, to creating, you know, this company DNA that is very unique, has this attention.
And I Steve was a really good judge of that kind of thing. And the thing that I would say here is that, if you watch the movie The Social Network, that is, I think we now know that some of those issues are still there, right?
Sure, well, of course.
Right? Right. But none of them were apparent to me. I never had any experience with him personally where that came up. So imagine when the movie came out, I'm looking at this going, hang on, he's grown out of that. I'm not going to go see this movie because I like the Mark I know, right?
Okay.
And so we have this thing where he only, you know, he had a lot of other advisors, and some of whom were much more influential than me. But I was able to do two things for him. One was helping him keep the company independent. But the second one has a funny story behind it. You may know that in the late 90s, the Dead reached out to me and said, hey, we hear know a lot about tech, and we hear you're a Deadhead. Would you come and help us? We're trying to, like, keep Grateful Dead Productions going because we got 60 employees and no tour, right? How do we keep everybody going? And some dude had brought them a proposal to do a thing. He was a real estate project called Terrapin Station. They were gonna get a whole city block in San Francisco and build this multi-use thing. It was gonna be like apartment block. It was gonna be an office tower. And on the ground floor, it was gonna have a museum. And Weir was convinced it was gonna have a roller coaster. And they were going to put the vault there and maybe have a small performance center. I mean, it was really ambitious. And I'm looking at this thing going, I don't know anything about real estate, but I'll be really surprised when the money gets tight if they do a roller coaster. I wouldn't count on that. Right?
Yeah.
And I said, I really don't know anything about real estate, but, you know, I know a lot about tech. And you've got Dead.net. And Tom, one of their roadies, had created Dead.net. And they were selling music and t-shirts, and they were selling a lot of music and t-shirts. I mean, so much so that it was almost offsetting the tour because it was more profitable than the tour. The tour kept everybody busy and kept them paid. Right. It didn't generate that much for the band.
Right.
I mean, sorry, it generated a very comfortable living for the band. But it's not the Dead.net couldn't catch up to it, right? It wasn't such a humongous number.
Well, most bands don't have 60 people on staff.
Well, that's the thing. They were so generous, and they had this whole scene, right?
Right.
And the ticket prices weren't crazy,
right?
They weren't. I mean, everything about it was a great thing if you were, like me, with a low income, and which I was during the period Jerry was alive. And so I go there and have this meeting. And I have a series of them. And the first meeting's about the real estate thing. And then I just explained to Phil, I go, dude, I really don't. You know, I really don't know anything about this. But I have this other idea. How about if we do, this thing? And so I spent 3 years on it, so I'm working with them on this idea. Uh-huh. And the notion was really simple. Dead.net was really simple. The technology, as you know, was incredibly primitive, but it worked because you went, and the person you called on the 800 number was somebody who worked in the warehouse, wow, who was part of the family, and you developed a personal relationship. It was just like the ticketing, right?
Yeah.
Except now it's for buying, you know, a Dick's Picks or whatever. And that stuff was all starting. Dick's Picks and the Vault releases were pretty new. And I was like, when they bring me in, I have to go in front of all of the employees. So it's me and Weir are sitting in these stools, and you got Big Steve and Ramrod, and all of the other employees are, you know, in Belmarin Keys in the kind of rehearsal space, and they're all in little chairs, and they grill me for like 2 hours, and they're trying to decide, am I just some Wall Street asshole, or am I going to be like a member of the tribe? And so we get into this really hilarious thing where, well, where are you at? And I finally have to turn around and go, so how many of you guys were in Telluride in 87 when Jerry had to do the restart of Brookdown Palace? Right? And obviously Ramrod and Big Steve were there, but most of the other people were not there. And I'm like, how many of you were in Hartford when Phil did the anniversary thing of the earthquake in San Francisco and, you know, recreated that whole thing? And, you know, there were very few people. And we were running through all of these, like, where you at? And I'd missed a bunch, but I'd been at Watkins Glen, right? And so I'd been at enough places, and I'd been at enough shows. And it was pretty obvious that you know, unlike most of the people who brought them business plans, I was okay, right? I mean, I might not have been great. I might not have been perfect, but I was okay.
Cool enough.
Yeah, exactly. So anyway, I get accepted into this thing. I spend 3 years on it. Hmm. So Bono hears about this. So, we're going out to talk to Dave Matthews, and we're talking to Fish, and we're talking to Pearl Jam, and we're talking to Jackson Brown and Bob Dylan. And we get this call. And it's from, it's really weird. Bono's going, at the time, it's 1999, and he's on this program to get rid of third world debt, right? Called the Millennium Debt Forgiveness Program.
Okay.
He's working with the U.S. Treasury Department. His contact there's a woman named Sheryl Sandberg. Ah. She's the chief of staff to the Secretary of the Treasury.
Oh, my goodness.
And he goes, I got to find this guy in California. She goes, you won't believe this. My brother-in-law works for him, and he's working on the Grateful Dead project with Roger.
Wow.
Now, I had not met Sheryl, but she knew of me. So she connects me to Bono.
Yeah.
In 2003, I leave Silver Lake, and Bono and I start Elevation. So, it's now 2007, and Mark Zuckerberg says, I got to get a new chief operating officer. And Sheryl has just contacted me and saying, I've got this great job offer to go to the Washington Post. And I go, Sheryl, are you nuts? You're at Google. You guys are killing the Washington Post. That's a terrible idea. You should go to work at Facebook instead. Huh. And she goes, what do you mean? He's 23. And I go, yeah, but he's so young. There's no way he's going to want to work with a woman who's 15 years older.
But he's 23.
Right? And I go, hang on. His mom's a doctor, right? Mm. He's got nothing but sisters. I think he'll be totally cool with a woman. Because all my experience with him said that was true. And so then I go to Mark and I go, I think you should hire Sheryl Sandberg. And he goes, but she's at Google. And I'm going, yeah? And he goes, well, Google's nothing like us. And I'm going, like, what is? I mean, give me a break. What's closer than Google? So, anyway.
Yeah.
They finally get together. Hit it off, like, perfectly and join forces. So those are the two things I did for Mark. And then...
And you... But the first thing is the ability to keep them private, to infuse some capital before it was time for them to go public.
No, he had plenty of capital. He didn't need money. When I first went to see him, he already had all the money he needed. All he needed to do was persuade everybody to stay independent.
Yeah, but you still invested.
Later.
Later,
I didn't get the chance to do that until...
You know, pre-IPO.
Yeah, but like a year after I first met him.
Okay.
Still way before the IPO. The thing with Mark was that he was always super professional with really cool. And so in 2009... Sheryl's fully on board. I have a slight disagreement with Sheryl on an issue, and I realize it's probably time for me to step back. He's got, you know, all great entrepreneurs, you know, they go through phases and they need different kinds of advice.
Yeah.
And people who are really helpful at one stage may not be helpful at another stage. And I'm looking at this, and I've learned this the hard way. And so I knew better than to hang around past my time. So I go to Mark and I go, "Dude, I think you've outgrown me." And so this is 2009. And I said, "You know, I'll still be around if you need me, but you're probably not going to need me much." And we still talked a little bit about, like, smartphones and things like that, because I was up to my ears in that business.
Yeah.
But so I disappear in the background, and I'm just like cheerleader. They go public in 2012. And then in 2016, my wife and I are on vacation. I'm on Facebook because I'm totally addicted to it.
Yeah.
And I all of a sudden, I see stuff that shouldn't be there. It's like one day.
Wait, before we get there, though, hold on. I do want to, I'm sorry to cut you off, but before we get there.
Dude, it's your show.
Yeah, I want to, before you start seeing what goes wrong, what is it about Facebook that they got so right early on?
So,
like, there were other people, they bought Instagram early, but, you know, early on, there was, you know, just the cliche, like, well, social networking. But there really wasn't social networking. There was Facebook. No. There weren't other people really getting this.
What is it
they did so right?
I think at the beginning, there was a technical thing they did right, and then there was the decisions. So the technical thing, when they were 20 years old, they had this idea that you could take graph theory, which was
the open graph thing
from mathematics, and use it as a network architecture, and that's what drove them to the decision that they were going to require authenticated identity, because if every person had only one point on the graph, if you're anonymous, you can be 20 or 50 points on the graph,
right?
But if everybody's only one point on the graph, it simplifies the architecture really dramatically, and it allows you to scale it a lot faster. So that initial insight about the architecture was brand new, and they had it when they were 20, and it was completely genius. And you look at that in retrospect and you go, once they get that decision right, almost everything that happened after that was relatively easy to do, because nobody before them had ever had that insight. So the architectures they had were always, they would always hit limits and break down. And this one had no obvious natural limit from a network design point of view. The limit would be if you ever relaxed real identity, or if people ever felt that they didn't have control of privacy, you were going to have a problem.
Yeah.
Now, in fact, as relatively early in this, they did make a decision to not enforce authenticated identity. They basically turned over that and everything else to the users. And they basically said, we're going to follow the old Silicon Valley mantra, which made sense for PC apps, that we'll release the product when we get it to work and let the customer sort out the bugs. And they basically did that. But their network design was so good that no obvious major flaws.
It's truly a great piece of architecture.
Yeah,
it's a great code base.
They had a few stumbles where they pushed too hard on privacy. They had a thing called Beacon where they were allowing basically retailers to post your retail transactions to your Facebook feed. And this was without your permission. So this was conspicuously a disaster because what happened was, like, on the first or second day, a guy went to Overstock and bought an engagement ring. And then it shows up and his fiance finds out he's going to propose on Facebook with a picture of the ring and the price, because he got it at a deep discount. And it was a disaster, right? And they pull out, I want to say they pulled it back after 4 months.
Well, that's a good little insight into privacy. Like,
he didn't believe in it. Okay, and this,
he didn't believe in Beacon or privacy.
In privacy.
Yeah. So I want to ask about that because, go on.
Well, the way I would characterize this is Mark was an idealist, still is an idealist in this sense. He believes that connecting everybody in the world is the most important thing you could possibly do, and he basically believes it's so important that it justifies any means necessary to get.
Okay. That being said, do you still feel, and I can say this for Cheryl too, and Mark, that they still believe that to be true from the perspective of actually connecting people for the sake of information, wanting to be free and to helping to exchange, you know, the human conversation? Or is it from an advertising perspective?
So I
can't tell anymore.
I don't know, because they don't talk to me anymore. It appears the following way. I think they still really believe in the mission. The problem is that they have created this system that includes surveillance, right? Massive data gathering. So Mark's basic belief right out the chute was that people's desire for privacy was a mistake, and that if they couldn't see it, he was going to help them see it, whether they wanted it or not. And so he was always pushing on that. I mean, think about it. Right back to when he first got started, he created this thing at Harvard called FaceMash, where he hacked the servers at Harvard to get all the photographs of all the students. I mean, he basically believed in disclosing and apologizing later, right? In fact, he has the famous line about move fast and break things.
Break things,
and
right.
In the book, I basically rephrase it as move fast, break things, apologize, repeat, right? Because he did the same things over and over again. And apologies always got him past the problems. You know, he was a really, really smart, really energetic white man. And that proved to be enough until very recently.
Yeah.
And so I think that they really believed it. When the advertising thing, when they created it, was really symbiotic with the Connect the World thing. Because when they started to build a business, they had obviously the largest collection of people in one place that any advertising medium had had, you know, the largest cohesive thing. And the problem they had at the beginning, and this would have been true in 2009, 10, 11, and 12, was that the data inside Facebook wasn't enough to make the targeting work really, really well. They had been collecting data. They basically, once they created Facebook Connect and they started putting like buttons around the web, they started to collect data on people moving around the web. And that turned
outside of their platform.
Outside of Facebook.
Yeah.
That turned out to have enormous signal value relative to advertising, because people were searching for products around the web and they would catch it that way.
Right. So all of this, you know, all connectivity, but there's surveillance and all of the hooks, like kind of creating this Facebook big data profile out there. That's a means to what end if it isn't for advertising?
I'm saying is I think it's a means to connecting the whole world, right?
Okay.
They effectively need to earn a profit in order to buy the servers in order to correct. I'm not apologizing for it. I'm explaining it as best I understand it, right? And so I think that...
And they've done that to some extent.
Oh, to more than a little extent.
Yeah.
I mean, to me, the miracle was that this thing got to 2 billion people worldwide before it blew up.
Jesus.
Right? I mean, these are really smart, really capable people.
Yeah.
What's missing is an understanding that the people who use the product are human beings entitled to self-determination.
Okay.
They're all reduced to being a metric, right? You're a metric, I'm a metric, and it's hang on, dudes. You've accomplished your wildest dreams. I mean, step back and just chill.
Another Silicon Valley person, luminary, told me this, that part of the issue is that Zuckerberg himself, as a human being, doesn't understand what you just said because he was too young, got rich too fast, too young, has always been in this bubble, and doesn't really have the humanity kind of thread. What made Steve so great was that the original dream crumbled. And there he was, like, holy fuck, I had this great thing and something got fucked up. I don't know what it was. Maybe it was me. And he had to take a look at that. And Mark's never had that.
Yeah.
It just happened so quickly.
He's having it now.
He's having it now.
And the question is he getting the message right?
Profits aren't hurting.
I'm going to push back a little bit on the Steve thing because, you know, look, I was not intimate with Steve Jobs at all, but I knew him for a long time and I knew him pretty well. And we did a lot of business things together. I'm a humongous admirer.
Me too.
Steve.
Oh, top five.
But Steve was not a perfect human being.
Yeah.
And he could be mean-spirited. He could be brutal.
Yeah.
And he could be petty. And yet he was also demonstrably the most extraordinary, creative, visionary person.
Yeah.
And his life was indisputably a massive net plus. The danger for Mark is that it's not clear that Facebook is a net plus today.
But
after Myanmar, after, you know, the
Cambridge Analytica and all
that
stuff.
Election interference around the world, but, you know, also the horrible things that take place on Instagram, you know, the bullying of preteens and teens and the fear of missing out and, you know, the election interference on WhatsApp. I mean, all of those things.
And what Instagram is doing for young women today. And
oh, it's awful.
It's terrible.
Yeah. No, I mean, and you know, you look at these things and you go, it doesn't have to be that way, right? That there's a cultural problem underlying all of this that is not unique to Facebook, right? I mean, I look at Google, and the thing I try to explain to everybody is that the book is called Zucked. I was closer to Facebook than I was to Google.
Sure.
I saw the problems at Facebook first. You know, the story begins with that. But what becomes clear to me in the book, and even more so since then, is that this is a problem with the data economy, and that Google's actually not been caught doing the same things as Facebook. But that's not because they're not doing horrible things.
Yeah.
And YouTube has been caught doing things every bit as bad as Facebook. Really horrific. And that's part of Google. But the guys who process credit cards, you know, so Experian and Equifax and TransUnion, I mean, they sell your credit card data to anybody. It's like, in the old days, that wasn't such a big deal. But now when you have artificial intelligence and you can find patterns in anything, you know, selling credit card data is dangerous. Selling geolocation data, which is what all the cellular carriers do. I mean, why do we allow that? Why do we allow people to sell credit card data? Why do we allow them to even collect data on minors, right?
Right.
I mean, these are all questions we need to revisit, because artificial intelligence, which Facebook is a user of, but they're not going to be a vendor of it the way that Google is, the way that Amazon is, the way that Microsoft is, the way that IBM is. You know, when we're looking forward, the issues that we're going to see are going to be much more related to artificial intelligence, going to be much more related to the Internet of Things. You know, smart devices with Alexa or Google Home as the voice interface.
Yeah.
Those things are listening all the time, and they're listening in places where...
I'm not sure about that.
There you go.
I rest my case.
Right on cue. So, but
that's, by the way, that's the second time that's happened to me on this book tour.
That's very funny.
And I just say to people, you have to think through, you know, whether the small amount of incremental convenience
is worth it.
It's worth the risk of things that are listening all the time. And I believe Amazon when they say they only record the things when you say, you know, when you give the prompt. I'm not going to say it.
Yeah, I'm not even sure if I believe that. I don't know.
The thing I just say, let's assume that they do.
Yeah, okay? Sure.
You still have two failure modes that you need to think about. Almost all these things are made by a couple of Japanese companies that are under investigation by our security and defense services because they're worried about them spying, right?
Yeah.
And they're Chinese companies. And then these things are eminently hackable because they're all built on Google's Android operating system. And I don't know if you saw this, but like a couple weeks ago, there was at least one family that had Google's Nest home security system got an alert that there were inbound nukes, right? And it's like, again, it was a malicious hack, but you could imagine other hacks that would produce really horrible outcomes.
Yeah,
right?
Man. Yeah.
And, you know, from my perspective, we have a blind trust of technology that is completely legitimate in the era of Steve Jobs, right?
Right.
That's not legitimate in the era of Google and Facebook.
So, in the context of Facebook, what is the first red flag that made you think this? You talk about it in the book, but I'd love to hear you say
so
now.
There are two red flags I should have picked up better that I didn't, okay? The first being Beacon with
taking the shopping stuff
and putting it online.
Yeah.
The second was I was at the TED conference in 2011, a guy named Eli Pariser, who was the head of MoveOn.
The filter bubble guy. Yeah,
well, so
love him.
He gives the original filter bubble speech where he's explaining that his Google and Facebook feeds are no longer neutral.
I've been trying to get him on the show for years. It's been hard.
He's a really good guy, worth having on. I hope he can pull it off. So Eli gives a speech, and he's basically explaining that Facebook and Google are tailoring the news feeds to what they think he already likes, stuff he's already shown. Okay. And they're not being honest about it. They're pretending like it's neutral when it's really not, and that's very dangerous. That was an unbelievable signal. Now, by then, I've been out of the company 2 years. So I'm, you know, still in rah-rah mode. And then it goes public, and everything seems to be going really, really well. So I'm completely in rah-rah mode. And then 2016 comes along. Mm. It's January, beginning of the New Hampshire primary. I'm on vacation with my wife. And I see on Facebook this really misogynistic meme, anti-Hillary meme, coming from a group that claims to be attached to the Sanders campaign. And I'm thinking to myself, wow, I can't imagine Bernie would go for that. The next day, like, it goes from one friend on day one to like four friends on day two, to like eight friends on day three, to like 16 friends on day four. And I'm going, what the hell's going on here? These are really misogynistic memes, everyday new ones. Mm. And these pages don't seem to have anything on them except these memes.
Right.
And yet all these friends of mine are getting it. It seemed like somebody was paying money to get people into these groups. And I'm thinking, why would you do that? Who would do that? And I don't know.
Ah.
And then the second thing happens, a couple months later, I read a report that Facebook has expelled a company that was using the advertising tools to gather data about people who expressed an interest in Black Lives Matter. And they were selling the names of these people to police departments. I mean, really evil, right?
Wow.
Now, Facebook does the right thing. They expelled them. But what I realized was, wow, by the time they expelled them, the harm had already been done, right?
Yeah.
It wasn't like they expelled them on day one. They expelled them after like 2 months. Then in June of 2016, the European Union Brexit vote in the United Kingdom happens.
Mm-hmm.
Are they going to leave the European Union or not? And the polling the night before the referendum is 4 points in favor of remaining, and the outcome is 4 points in favor of leaving.
Mm.
And the Leave campaign had a really different strategy than the Remain campaign. Remain basically was saying, we got the best economic deal in the European Union. Stay the course. Everything's fine. The Leave campaign's going, those evil foreigners, those immigrants are destroying our culture, our way of life, and they're going to attack your children and, you know, eat your dog. And they were blaming immigrants for everything real and imagined that was wrong with the United Kingdom.
Yeah.
And it occurred to me that it's possible that those ads had spread more effectively over Facebook than the Remain campaign's very neutral. You know, that Facebook seemed to be about kind of intense things. And the problem, this is where I'm really mad at myself.
Mm.
It was totally possible for me by then to already understand the psychological stuff, but I don't yet know.
Right.
Then comes the August, we find out about Paul Manafort and the Russian ties. I'm going, whoa, okay, that's weird. And then in October, we find out that the Department of Housing and Urban Development had cited Facebook because the advertising tools allowed people in real estate to discriminate based on, you know, factors like race in violation of the Fair Housing Act.
Yeah.
So at this point, I've got two things that are sort of electoral related and two things that are civil rights related, and I'm freaked out. And then we get the news in October also that the intelligence agencies have told the president that the Russians are trying to interfere in the election. I'm thinking to myself, whoa, what if they're part of what I've seen?
How are they trying to interfere? So
right?
You can connect the dots.
I don't know.
Yeah.
So I wrote this opinion piece for a tech blog called Recode.
Yeah.
And it was a bit emotional, but I'm basically going, the algorithms and the business model of Facebook are allowing bad actors, bad guys, to hurt innocent people. Right. And I'm thinking Facebook's a victim. I send this thing, instead of publishing, I send it to Mark and Cheryl. And I go, guys, we got a real problem here. You got to get on this. And to their credit, they got back to me immediately, I mean, within a couple hours. And they go, Roger, appreciate your reaching out. We disagree that these are systemic problems. We think they're isolated. We think we've taken care of them, but we value your opinion. So we're going to hand you off to Dan Rose, who's, you know, our right-hand guy, and you know Dan well, and you can work with Dan, and we'll figure this thing out. So I talked to Dan, and Dan's explained to me, Roger, we're a platform, not a media company. We have this Section 230 of the Communications Decency Act that says that we're not responsible for what third parties do. And I'm going, Dan, I think these are systemic issues. I really think you just need to look at it, right? Just do us both a favor and look at it. Then the election happens. Hmm. And the next day, and this is where the book begins, the next day I send this email to Dan. And it's more, I don't describe it in the book as colorfully as I said it, but I go, the fucking Russians tipped the election using Facebook. Hmm. And that begins a different conversation.
Yes.
Which goes on for 3 months. And I'm going, Dan, you can't hide behind a law. You're in a trust business. If people decide that you're not trustworthy, Facebook is doomed. You can't, you gotta get on top. You gotta do what Johnson & Johnson did when that dude put poison in bottles of Tylenol. They took every bottle of Tylenol off the shelf, every store in America. And they didn't put it back until they'd invented tamper-proof packaging. I think you got to do the equivalent of that for Facebook. You've got to take care of the people who use the product. He's going, Roger, we're a platform. No,
yeah, man, it's...
You can't even imagine how frustrating this was.
Wow. And
what's weird, what I didn't know at the time, was that President Obama had met Mark at some event, and they'd had a short conversation about it. And, I mean, Mark famously... the day after the election said it was crazy to think the Russians had interfered on Facebook. Then he meets President Obama, who basically says to him, you really need to look at this. And then in December, Facebook's own security chief, Alex Stamos, produces a report to explain what happened, which the company winds up suppressing. And or at least they suppressed the most biting parts of it. So they clearly know by then, right? But they're pretending there's nothing to see all the way into the end of October of 2017, when the night before they're supposed to appear in front of the Senate Intelligence Committee, they release a report that says, well, yeah, the Russians interfered on Facebook and they reached 126 million Americans. Not a random 126, but a carefully targeted 126. Now, this is following an election which only 131 million Americans voted, right? And so your immediate reaction was, holy yeah! I mean, right? I mean, this is a disaster.
Yeah.
And so they're finally beginning to come clean, right? But for me, the period between February, when I give up talking to him, and October, when that comes out, I'm first looking for allies. And I find a guy named Tristan Harris. He'd been at Google.
Sure.
He was the design ethicist there. He was on 60 Minutes. And I met him 2 days later because I was interviewing him on behalf of Bloomberg. And his 60 Minutes pitch was called brain hacking. And he was talking about how the advertising and the product design of things like Facebook, like Google, like Instagram, like Snapchat, and smartphones themselves are designed to create habits. And they do that with things like reminders and notifications and like buttons and tagging and these things.
Behavioral assessment.
The things that trigger these evolutionary, low-level evolutionary things that are common to everybody. And that once they get you coming back, then they want to appeal to lizard brain emotions like outrage and fear because that causes you to share more stuff. Because when you're afraid,
you want other people to be afraid, because if there's more people afraid, then you can relax.
And not only share it, but also share it with like much more angst.
Exactly.
That's the thing.
And so it builds up. You're right. These outrage cycles get going. Well, until I read this transcript, until I interviewed Tristan, I had no idea about this stuff. And it was just like, oh my God, now I see the whole thing. Yeah. And I call him up. I go, dude, do you need a wingman, right? Because it's like, and you know, because at this point, I've concluded that it's my duty to do something.
Absolutely,
right?
Yeah.
And, you know, this is me coming from our world and looking at this and going, oh, my God, I was part of this. You know, my role was small, but it mattered.
Mm-hmm. And you had their ear.
Well,
I mean, that's
actually, I didn't. But what I had was, I had a biography that said I had once had their ear. Therefore, if I said something, I would be more credible than just some schmo coming in off the street.
Okay, well,
right?
Yeah.
That what I really concluded was the problem was I didn't have their ear. Right? If I'd had their ear, the thing would have been resolved privately. But what they did was they weren't, you know, they treat it like a PR problem, not like a real problem. Right?
It's an important distinction.
Right? They treat it like a PR problem.
Yes. It's the perception thing.
Right? And so they're going like, we just got to get this guy to shut up. Right? Right? And they thought they had succeeded. But I meet Tristan, and we go around, and the first thing we do is we go to, in fact, Eli Pariser, the filter bubble guy, gets Tristan at the last minute onto the schedule of the TED conference in Vancouver, the headquarters of TED Talks. And people normally prepare for 6 months. Tristan has 2 weeks. We get him on there, and there's polite applause, and we're thinking there's 1,000 people here. These are our troops. We're going to get them together. We're going to reform this thing. It's going to all happen right here, and then we can go back to what we were doing before. Two people gave us business cards, and neither one of them followed up. I mean, to characterize TED as having been a disappointment, it's like,
wow.
It would be like getting married and having nobody show up.
Yeah.
And we're really stuck, and we don't know what to do. So we go to New York and think, well, we set up, like, we find a person, the Financial Times will talk to us, a person at the ACLU, and then the woman who had done Tristan's makeup for 60 minutes, turned out her regular gig was that she does Arianna Huffington's makeup. And she told Arianna, who is one of the great, I mean, she created the Huffington Post, and she's
a great voice.
Extraordinarily thoughtful, both entrepreneur and activist.
Yeah.
And she knows everybody. So the makeup person says, Arianna, in 10 years, I've never told you to interview somebody. You've got to interview this kid. So she meets him, takes him under her wing, and you know, gets him on Bill Maher and all these other things. Meanwhile, I get handed a business card for a guy who worked for Senator Mark Warner on the Senate Intelligence Committee. So Warner's the co-chair, and that was the only committee in 2017 where the Republicans and the Democrats sort of collaborated. Everywhere else it was just open hostility. But on that one committee, they were kind of together. So I said to the guy, I know your mandate is intelligence agency, so you're focused on Trump Tower and the Russians and all that, but who's going to protect the 2018 election from interference on Facebook and Instagram and YouTube? And short pause, and the guy goes, you're right, this really matters. I'm going to get you in front of Warner. So we go and see Warner in July of 2017. We go see Elizabeth Warren in the morning. She's really focused on this stuff. We see Warner afterwards. And those are the only two meetings we can get. But we get meetings with these two very senior, very smart senators. And Warner basically goes, I get exactly your point. There's nobody with jurisdiction over this. If we don't do it, it's not going to happen. So what do you recommend we do? And Tristan, bless his heart, goes, dude, you got to have a hearing. And you got to make Mark Zuckerberg come and explain what the hell happened?
Yeah.
And why, you know, what they're doing.
I have a question as you're telling the story, though. In your mind, because when I first started learning about this stuff, the wheel kind of shifted in my own head when I found out that 40 to 50% of this Russian interference weren't just trolls, but bots. A lot of it was automated.
I think it maybe even more than that.
But that was also a different thing, because I'm Mr. EFF all the way. It's a platform, information wants to be free. You know, I love Barlow. All that stuff is in my blood, man.
Right.
But that's what tipped it for me where it's going, you can't hide behind that anymore.
It turns out that there were many things we were wrong about.
Yes.
And if bots are just contaminating your site.
So that's a difference to me.
John Perry Barlow and I, like you, I was a friend of Barlow, and I was an early and very aggressive supporter of EFF.
Yeah.
But I came to a, shall we say, philosophical adjustment along the way as a consequence of what's happened here.
Yeah.
And I think the EFF will eventually catch up, but they were so committed to the hyper-libertarian model that it's been very hard for them to accept. So here's the problem.
Yeah.
Cass Sunstein, who was the former White House tech advisor. Mm.
For Obama.
Okay. Did a study that suggested that, in ballpark terms, you could move... It may have been Jonathan Morgan at Data for Democracy, but one of those two guys did a study that said that one troll and then bots equal to 1-2% of a group online were all that it would take to change the direction of the group. And this was based on the notion that when you have a mob, roughly 2% of the mob acting aggressively can get the whole mob to follow.
Okay.
And their assertion was this would be true online, and it would only take one troll and then a fleet of bots. And it does appear that in the Russian-controlled Facebook group, so this would be the secessionist movement for California was the first one we saw, the one at the secessionist movement in Texas. These pro and anti-Islam groups, the pro and anti-Black Lives Matter groups, that they were using really high ratios of trolls to of bots to trolls, and that in aggregate they were roughly trying to get to ballpark 2%. They were trying to get in, you know, they were trying to get, they would create this thing. So initially it was just the troll and the bots. Mm. And then they would recruit people in, and they would try to get them to that ratio. And I don't know where they got. I don't have that level of detail. But there's no question that they had the ability to influence these groups really profoundly, and the groups would be populated with Americans who had no idea that they were being manipulated. By the way, the nature of how Facebook and Instagram work makes that very easy. And the reason is because, you know, if you start out getting hit with likes and notifications and you build a habit, some percentage of the people who get a habit are going to get an addiction. And when people are addicted, they're vulnerable to manipulation. And what's been proven is if you can get a person to be curious about something, you know, Obama born in Kenya, anti-vax, flatter,
whatever,
you know,
chemtrails, whatever thing. Yeah.
That if you can get them into a group on the subject, the constant reinforcement from the group will make their position hardened and more extreme. And once you can get them into one conspiracy theory, getting them into a second one has a much more And so Facebook had, and candidly, this is where YouTube's really dangerous also. But Facebook, YouTube, Instagram really magnify belief in conspiracy theories and in disinformation. Because MIT did the study that says that disinformation on internet platforms spreads 70% further and 6 times faster than facts do.
Wow.
And you know,
just 2 weeks ago, I finally made it to the Alex Jones show. My picture was in there in reference to the Alex Jones Rogan thing because of my lineage. I'm obviously a CIA operative poisoning the world with psychedelic warfare. And from that little, you know, 10 seconds of my image being up there talking to Rogan.
Teach your parents well, I believe, is what the song says.
Wow, man. So, okay. Yeah, so I know your time is limited, so I got to be... I do want to make sure we get into this. The problem being what it is, and you articulating it very, very, very well. Well, first tell me, after, from your where you stand now, whose purview is it to take care, to make sure these problems get resolved? Besides the user.
So I think that, look, when people are addicted, right, they lose a lot of agency, and so you can't expect people to fix all their own problems.
This is what I want to ask, so what do we do about it?
And believe that the really important thing is there is a very important role for government to play in this, and there's a very important role for the employees of these companies to play in it. Mm. One of the things that I've been hoping for initially was to convince Mark and Sheryl at Facebook, and then by analogy, Larry and Sergey at Google, that so far I'm the wrong messenger for them, so that didn't work out. Ideally, we'd like to then convince the employees to do it. And at Google, there have been signs, right? You've had the walkout relative to forced arbitration for sexual misconduct. You've had protests related to the censored search engine Dragonfly in China. And, you know, you've had protests about drones, and you've had small protests elsewhere. But you haven't really seen any protests anywhere against business practices. You haven't seen any protests at Facebook against the ethnic cleansing in Myanmar, for example. And so, you know, all of that is troubling. My partner Tristan continues to meet with employees of Facebook to try to get them energized and mobilized. It hasn't happened yet. I do not give up hope. The way I characterize this, I think Mark and Sheryl and all the employees are one good night's sleep away from the epiphany, right, that they need to have. So I'm hopeful there. But government becomes the last thing, right?
But does profits matter here, Roger? I mean, as long as, like, companies, like, I know Facebook had a very good quarter last quarter, you know? I mean, I would think that being in their seat, as long as profits continuing to be what they are, the motivation for change isn't really so, like, important, other than it's the right thing to do.
I think that part's right.
I mean, people deleting their accounts, is that what it's going to take?
I think that's unrealistic, right? And so I don't want to pretend that deleting their accounts is most likely to be the thing that happens next. I think that the way I would put it, we're dealing with a situation where I want to reassess issues like privacy in the context of looking at whole classes of data that are currently freely exchanged that, in my opinion, shouldn't be. Financial data being the most obvious, geolocation data being really obvious. I think that micro-targeting as done by Facebook and Google in the context of elections.
Sure.
There are all kinds of free speech issues around that, but it's so harmful. The notion that candidates no longer need to stand for something, that what they can do instead is exploit the fears or weaknesses of each individual voter separately, that's just terrible for democracy. We need to find some solution to that. I think we have to find a way to create alternatives. There's nothing inevitable about these people. In fact, the point I make is that we as users, and or humans formerly known as users, have much more power than we give ourselves credit for. We have the power to change our usage. For example, one of the things I do is I worked hard to avoid Google. And people go, Roger, how do you do that? And I go, well, I treat it like a video game. I pretend it's Frogger. I'm the frog. Google's the river. The logs are the products I use to avoid Google. And I got to be honest with you, you have to accept a significant increase in inconvenience because the Google products
are pretty hard to do. Yeah.
But it's worth it if you make it a game. So, you know, I have DuckDuckGo as my search engine. Yeah, okay. I have Safari as my browser. Mm-hmm. I have, you know, the Microsoft email system. I have the Microsoft apps. I have Ghostery to block trackers. I have, you know, 1Password for logging onto things. And, you know, I use Signal for texting. I mean, I would never use Signal from, or I never use Messenger from Facebook anymore. Mm-hmm. I used to use it all the time. So I use all those things, and every once in a while I'm on the web and I inadvertently, like, I'm looking up a restaurant and I hit the map and it's a Google map and I blow myself up and I'm in the river and I have to start again. But my high score, I've gone 2 whole months, right? Which is a pretty good high score. Now, avoiding Google Docs for me is the hardest thing, because everybody I work with uses Google Docs. And I just explain to them, I'm sorry, I'm an activist and I can't use Google. You're either going to have to send me a PDF of it or, you know, send me a Word document. There are substitutes for everything Google does, right?
Yes.
You have to be willing to accept some incremental inconvenience. But here's the question I ask everybody. I say, look, if you knew that by taking on a little inconvenience and spreading your business around and not using these platforms as platforms, using them for the one thing you really need from them, if you knew that by doing that, you could help to restore democracy, that you could improve your public health and that of your children, you could regain the ability to make choices without fear.
Yes.
You could help the economy. Would you do that? And I think most people would.
I think
we have to do it as groups, right? The cool thing is parents need to get together and, like, have device-free play dates. And you need to go to schools and say, look, except for special needs kids, we don't want computers in the classroom. We want the kids learning to pay attention, learning to focus, right?
Engage.
Right?
Humanity.
And, you know, there are all these things. And in the book, imagine the arc of the book, which you've read, is that I'm Jimmy Stewart, or I'm Howard Beale, but it's basically Rear Window, because at the beginning I know nothing, right?
Yeah.
And all of a sudden I see something that looks like a crime scene and I just pull on the thread and I tell you that narrative, and I use that narrative to both reveal the story as I learned it, but also to educate each reader about not the technology, but about the things you need to understand to protect yourself. And then I finish the book by telling you what you can do, what government does, and then what I'm doing. And the point, the government thing, is they have to use antitrust law to allow a different model to happen. We need to get back to Steve Jobs' old vision. He used to talk about computers as something that empowered people. He called them bicycles for the mind. And we've forgotten that. Now we're taking away humanity instead of building it. And that, there's no excuse for that. It's just lazy.
And I think it's such a beautiful thing, what you just said, but it's really like this change in, like, the vernacular, in that, like, that these things are just services and that you're either on the service or you're not. It's much more, the implications are much more powerful than that.
Yeah.
And, like, you're exposing that in your book, which is, like, the biggest takeaway for me.
Right. You look at Alexa and you're thinking to yourself, I'm getting a way to play my playlist better. And I'm going, hang on, stop. Don't let a computer, don't let Spotify tell you what you should listen to.
Right.
Right?
Yes.
Don't.
Facebook is not just a place to share your family photos.
Well, it is a place to share your family photos. The problem is that in sharing your family photos, you lose a lot of control of other parts of
life. Yes, you do.
And people say to me, Roger, my data's out there. You know, I can't get it back, and I'm a good guy, so it doesn't matter. I go, that's not the problem anymore. The problem is there's this thing called behavioral surplus.
That's right, yes.
Which is the things that they can learn about me, Zach, from looking at your data. It's the damage they can do to society from the looking at the behaviors of one person and interpolating what that means about other people. The reason why we need to give them way less data is because they are messing with our minds, and they are messing with our economy, they're messing with our culture.
And now messing with our elections.
Well, they're not doing that. They're letting other people do that, okay?
Yep.
And that distinction is really important, because these are not evil people.
Sure.
But they've never been told no. They've never been told that they should limit their behavior.
Yeah.
And it's time that we do that. And we have to do it now. And the thing, if you read the book, the thing I would say is it's very optimistic, because we do have more power than we realize. And importantly, it's really a call to not let devices mediate your whole life, right?
Right.
You know,
Get together with people, smoke some weed.
You know, man, like you were saying earlier that Facebook thought of this as a PR problem. To me, if I was working in PR at Facebook, I would think this would be an amazingly positive PR story for them to get on top of this, to fix it, to bring it out into the public discourse.
And
it's a win-win.
Every time you have a problem like this, it creates a business opportunity for someone.
Absolutely.
And it should have been a business opportunity for them. And the longer they sit there and resist, the more likely it is that the business opportunity will go for new people. Well, and by the way, God bless. That's the American way.
You got to get to Hollywood.
Yeah.
Thank you, man.
I mean, so much fun always. Let's do this again soon.
Thank you. I'd love to, man.